Hello, I'm Alyssa Ford Morrell. I'm an Extension Master Gardener with the Master Gardeners of Northern Virginia. Here today to talk about an invasive plant, Asian bamboo. But before I get going on that, I want to make sure that I am clear what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about just any old plant that spreads too much in your garden and you have to pull out the babies. Instead, I'm talking about a very formal definition that was first laid out in 1999 when President Clinton signed Executive Order 13112 and was later amended by President Obama in 2016 when he signed Executive Order 13751. And those orders say that an invasive plant is, first of all, not native where it is occurring or where it is introduced, and that it is able to cause harm to the economy, to the environment, or cause harm to human, animal, or plant health. There are a few American bamboos, but they are, of course, not invasive. The Asian bamboos in general are. There's at least four different kinds of Asian bamboos that are pretty common. They are golden bamboo, yellow groove bamboo, bisset bamboo, and arrow bamboo. They started being introduced to America in the late 1800s and have been widely sold ever since. The bamboos are really liked because they create quite nice privacy screens. And they have a really interesting, nice Asian vibe for people that want that look in their yard. However, they are considered highly invasive. They're on the invasive lists formally for the County of Arlington, the City of Alexandria, the entire Commonwealth of Virginia, and a lot of jurisdictions throughout the Mid-Atlantic. A lot of jurisdictions in this area are also starting to pass ordinances to limit bamboo because of all the problems that it causes. The problems related to bamboo are around the fact that it is so incredibly vigorous. It's hard for me to believe, but bamboo can grow up to 20 inches a day and, in fact, spread 30 feet away from the parent. The roots can grow 30 feet by rhizome away, forming a new plant that can then spread again, creating colonies up to 10 miles in diameter. It's huge and incredibly vigorous. All that growth can be really damaging to hardscapes. Concrete can be cracked. It creates monocultures and it creates erosion because there's no other plants that can grow around it. It limits biodiversity. The bamboo can collect water in which mosquitoes can breed, and actually roaches are also attracted to bamboo. It is a real problem for biodiversity. Getting rid of bamboo, unfortunately, is really hard to do. You can try to dig it out. The problem is that any single node of the rhizome that is left in place can resprout and restart the entire infestation. So really, digging only works for quite small and quite young infestations. Larger ones can be tackled with heavy equipment that can dig everything out, but then you have to sort through the soil very carefully because you've got to get all those rhizomes out or they can all resprout. If you're trying to do that sort of work by hand on a large infestation, you're going to be needing to plan to dedicate yourself for several years to digging it out and redigging anything out that you missed. Other options include using a systemic herbicide, which generally tends to work a little bit better. But if you're going to do that, for one thing, you need to research what kind of herbicide is the right one for the kind of bamboo that you have. And then use it very carefully according to label directions and with appropriate protective clothing. That can work fairly well. One last removal option that frankly is probably what I would want to do if I had a bamboo infestation is to hire a professional company. But if you do that, be sure to research and ask them for their track record of how successful they've been in getting rid of bamboo. You don't want somebody who doesn't have experience with this area. Fortunately, there are some great native alternatives to invasive Asian bamboo. For alternatives to bamboo, we have to think about why people like bamboo. For one thing, it is that it's a very tall plant that, if you contain it in a narrow space, can provide some really good privacy in a tall, narrow space. So as an alternative, we're going to go to something that doesn't look like grass at all, and that is Thuja occidentalis arborvitae, this wonderful evergreen tree that is native to much of the eastern seaboard. It grows 20 to 60 feet, so it can really provide some coverage in a tall area, potentially between multi-storied homes. It grows 10 to 15 feet wide. There are different varieties, so you would want to look for a variety that fits your space the best. But it's evergreen and really quite forgiving of a lot of situations. The problems with it tend to be around snow and ice, because if snow builds up, it can damage the weight can damage the plant and kind of knock it over, perhaps make a split in it. So it's really best to find one that is single trunked. Arborvitae likes wet feet. It can take some moisture. It handles clay pretty well. It is nice and supportive of a number of animals and is overall quite a great plant to have if you want privacy. For our next plant, I'm going to cheat a little bit. I'm going to recommend three different plants to you, but one technique. And that technique is also designed to provide privacy in a narrow space, potentially a pretty tall space. And that is that you can use either a fence or a very tall trellis that could be purpose-built for providing privacy, and grow one of our great native semi-evergreen vines on that fence or trellis. The first vine that I'm going to recommend is Bignonia capriolata, cross vine. This vine right here at the Glen Carlin Library Garden, where we have it providing privacy between us and the properties around us. We're filming this in mid-January, and you can see it is really quite green, and it's not allowing you to see through these leaves. So it really does provide the privacy. In May to June, it has gorgeous flowers in red, orange, yellow colors, quite large. They're big hummingbird attractors, and it's a really great plant. It can grow up to 45 feet tall, so that's a pretty tall fence or trellis, and you can really be providing a lot of privacy in that amount of space. The next vine I'd like to recommend for growing on a fence or trellis is Gelsomium sempervirens, Carolina jessamine. The pretty yellow flowers of this vine can bloom as early as December and make a wonderful late winter, early spring show for you. The vine can grow to be 10 to 20 feet tall. In winter, the leaves develop an interesting purplish patina, and of course they are semi-evergreen, so they're going to be there providing privacy as long as you need. Here's Lanicera sempervirens, or coral honeysuckle, growing on a trellis on my own home.
It makes a wonderful show of blooms in early spring and then blooms on and off for the rest of the summer, followed by berries that birds like to eat. A well-established coral honeysuckle vine, which can grow to be 20 feet high, is almost a guarantee of bringing hummingbirds to your yard. For those who like the fact that bamboo is a grass, our third replacement suggestion is a native grass, Alimus hystrix, bottlebrush grass. As the name implies, bottlebrush grass has lovely, showy seed heads that look a bit like a bottlebrush. It grows to be up to 4 feet high and can be quite dense, so it can provide some privacy at the lower levels. Bottlebrush grass can take either sun or shade, and it is really supportive of a number of different animals, including birds that eat the seeds and various Lepidoptera who use it as a host plant. Whichever native plant you choose to replace Asian bamboo, I wish you happy gardening.